gospel that shows up so beautifully in Psalm 103. Well, tonight I want to talk to you about the first of two dangerous resources that the enemy uses in his battle against us. We've learned much about the enemy himself and his malicious and powerful, his maliciousness and the great power that he has to battle against us. And now we learn the first of two resources. We have learned that we have a three-headed enemy, the world, the flesh, and the devil. Well, the devil is the head of those three, if you will, and it is the devil that craftily and, we can say, maliciously uses the world against us as well as our own flesh. These are his great instruments and tools. John Downham says these are his two captain generals, the world and the flesh. Tonight we'll look at the world, Lord willing. Next week we'll look at the flesh, which of course is our own sinful flesh, our own sinful heart. So if we have a warning tonight, it's a warning against worldliness. And the trouble of worldliness is we tend to think of it as something that's out there that threatens us. The trouble about worldliness is it's in here. It's in our own hearts. Again, because of our own fallenness and because of the attractions of the world finds an answer in our own sinful desires. We love praise. We love applause. And the world is good at this, and Satan uses the world to praise and to applause and to flatter. Satan also uses the world to terrify us, and to cause us to be afraid, cause us to cower and to turn away from following Christ and turn away from the gospel because we don't like pain. We don't like suffering. We don't like reproach. We don't like ridicule. We don't like mockery. So the world is a tremendous tool in the hands of the enemy. He uses it wisely, uses it powerfully. He has ever used it since his entering upon it as a fallen creature, and he will continue to use it with great success unless we are battling against it and standing guard against it with the armor the Lord has given us, which again will start in a couple of weeks, Lord willing. So what do we mean by the world? Well, the world is what's around us. It's what's fallen. John Downham says we mean that impious, ungodly, unbelieving men with all their baits and enticements to vanity and all their discouragements and afflictions. So there's the two sides. Baits and enticements on the one hand. The world will either entice you and allure you and bait you, or it will discourage you and afflict you on the other. Seeking to hinder and persecute God's children on the paths of righteousness. Paul talks about this in the opening verses of Ephesians chapter 2. You can turn there. And remember, Paul speaks about our fallen, our previous condition, our condition before we're saved by grace. All mankind fallen into sin, fallen in Adam. We live in this world. We are of the world. We are in it and we are of it. We belong to it. It is our home. And you see it clearly, as we'll learn from what Jesus says in John 15 and 16, it's not until we come out of the world that the world hates us. Right? The world opposes us because Christ calls us out. He saves us from it. But as long as we're in it, the world loves us. And we love the world. We applaud each other. Paul says here in Ephesians 2, "And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience." That's all of us. That's all of us by nature. The course we take is the course of the world. We live horizontally. We do not live vertically. Right? We don't move upward. We move forward in the world. We seek to advance ourselves, advantage ourselves, use and abuse to our own desire and liking for our own ends and purposes. That's worldly living. Self-centered living. The world is that which lives without God, without Christ. Turn over to Ephesians 2, look what Paul says beginning in verse 12. Again, this is the world. He says, "Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world." That's the world. It's the world without God. It's the world that lives without God. It's the world that lives selfishly, atheistically, or otherwise religiously without the Lord, having no fear of God before their eyes, as Paul says in Romans 3. Turn over to 2 Timothy. Remember how Paul describes unbelievers. 2 Timothy 2, look at verse 22, Paul says to young Timothy, "So flee youthful passions and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord from a pure heart. Have nothing to do with foolish, ignorant controversies. You know that they breed quarrels. And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but kind to everyone, able to teach, patiently enduring evil, correcting his opponents with gentleness. God may perhaps grant them repentance leading to a knowledge of the truth, and they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil after being captured by him to do his will." What is the snare of the devil? The snare of the devil is the world, among many other things, of course, but he snares us with the world, blinds us, so that we are blinded in our senses. Remember 2 Corinthians 4, right? We're blinded. There's a veil over the eyes of the unbeliever. They don't see the light of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. It has to be shown into our hearts by God's powerful, regenerating grace. But without that, we are blind. Our senses are no good, because every part of us is totally depraved, and we are fallen, and we see everything from a worldly perspective. That's the world. Turn to John 15, and again, remember what our Savior says. John 15 and 16. John 15, beginning in verse 18. If the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Notice the distinction, the clear distinction between belonging to the world and not belonging to the world, being of the world, in agreement with the world, going downstream with the world, or swimming upstream by the grace of God, moving in the opposite direction. Then the world hates you. Remember the word He says that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. They persecuted me, they will also persecute you. That's the world. Look at what he says in chapter 16, beginning in verse 1. I have said all these things to you to keep you from falling away. They will put you out of the synagogues. Indeed, the hour is coming when whoever kills you will think he is offering service to God. And they will do these things because they have not known the Father nor me. And then verse 33, of course. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. But take heart, I have overcome the world. Mm-hmm. And how do we overcome the world? Turn to 1 John chapter 5. Christ overcame the world. How does his people overcome the world? 1 John chapter 5. Verse 4. John says, for everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Again, speaking of what we learned in Sunday school this morning, this is how we are united to Christ by faith, and we're united to his victory. His victory that overcomes the world. His victory that is able to live in the world, but not of the world. The victory that Christ had over the world is a victory that we can enjoy as we walk contrary to it, live opposite of it, when it seeks to go in the ways of sin, and we need to go in the ways of the Lord our God. So the wicked world, then, is the devil's chief champion, and it assaults us on both sides. On the one hand, by fawning, on the other hand, by frowning. So by flattery and by affliction. So on the one hand, on the right hand, it entices us with favor, prosperity, and pleasure, that it might allure us into the ways of sin. Remember Vanity Fair and Pilgrim's Progress, right? We read there, John Bunyan said, every pilgrim must go through Vanity Fair. But what's the only way to make it safely through? Eyes were up, right? Not meddling with the peddlers. Not seeking to entangle with the world. Eyes were up, looking up. We're here to buy the truth. And if there is no truth, we're walking straight through. But we have to go through the world, right? The path of the Christian went through Vanity Fair. It has to and it must. This is the wilderness in which we live. We live in this world, but we walk contrary to it, just as they did there in Pilgrim's Progress. And of course, you remember, right, Christian's brother was slain, right? Faithful was slain. He died in Vanity Fair. Why? Because of his opposition to the world, his refusal to be of it, his refusal to walk with it, in step with it, to agree with it, and to come down to its level. Instead, to walk contrary is going to cost. And so we carry our cross to the world. The world hates us. The world despises us. The world mocks and ridicules. But why? because it hated and mocked and ridiculed Christ before us. Exactly what our Lord said in the Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are those then who walk in this way, because they will indeed walk in the way of Christ. So on the right hand, the world entices us with favor, prosperity, and pleasure that might allure us into the ways of sin, that it might hinder us from running the Christian race, that it might bring us to dishonor God and forsake Christ. And the trouble of the world when it approaches us in this way is it is hard to resist a flattering world. It is hard to resist a world that offers such wonderful things, right? It is hard because it is so attractive, right? It appeals to the flesh. It appeals to our desire for comfort or ease and our desire to have no persecution and no suffering and no ridicule and no mockery and no cross, just ease and comfort. And the world plays on this. The devil uses the world to play on this so that it offers us comforts if we will turn away from God, pleasures if we'll turn away from God, peace, calm. The world will be at peace with us if we will just walk with it and not contrary to it. And it is very enticing. It tugs at the heart mightily, and it is hard for God's people to resist. As we'll learn later, God's people do better in adversity than in prosperity. Prosperity is a typical stumbling block for the people of God. Look at Solomon, right? The wisest man in all the world, and yet look what prosperity did to him, what all those benefits did to him, what a great hindrance they were to him. But however hard it is, we must oppose the world when it approaches us in this way, because we need to remember several things. First of all, we need to remember the power of the world may fawn upon us and flatter us and offer all of these things to us. It is a mortal enemy. It is a mortal, deadly enemy which fights against us under Satan's banner. Turn to John 12, 31. This last week, looking at one of the names assigned to our enemy. Jesus says in John 12, 31, now is the judgment of this world. Now will the ruler of this world be cast out. The ruler of the world being Satan himself. So the world is under Satan's rule, right? Turn to 1 John chapter 5 again. Obviously, John's gospel, John's epistles, you have many, many overlaps. In the 1 John chapter 5, John says it more clearly here. John 5, 19, we know that we are from God, and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. The whole world lies in the power of the evil one. Now, Psalm 24 says the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Satan doesn't own the world in any sense at all. But the world is given over to Satan in terms of humanity, in terms of the hearts of men, in terms of the bent and the inclinations of men, in terms of the fallenness and the depravity of this world. Right? God's people, if we are called, we're called out of the world. We go contrary to the world. The world is on a particular course. It's following the master, its master Satan. Salvation is a plucking out of that, a brand from the fire, and going in the opposite direction. So this is the direction the world is going. This is the track it's on. It's the broad way that leads to death. And we are placed by grace into the narrow way that leads to life. And so whatever we think of the world, whatever the world may, however it may put itself off to us, as attractive, as safe, as easy, as harmless, as benign, it's fighting under the banner of the evil one. So that there may be honey in its mouth, but there's a deadly poison in its tail, because the end of its sins is always destruction. The wages of sin is death. And it goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden in Genesis 2:17. In the day you eat of it, you shall surely die. Nothing follows the course of this world but death. Turn to Revelation 18. Revelation 18, wonderful praise and testimony of the fallen Babylon. Verse 1, after this I saw another angel coming down from heaven, having great authority, and the earth was made bright with his glory, and he called out with a mighty voice, fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. That's this evil world. Here it's called Babylon by symbolism. Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. She has become a dwelling place for demons, a haunt for every unclean spirit, a haunt for every unclean bird, a haunt for every unclean and detestable beast. For all nations have drunk the wine of the passion of her sexual immorality, and the kings of the earth have committed immorality with her, and the merchants of the earth have grown rich from the power of her luxurious living. Then I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, lest you take part in her sins, lest you share in her plagues. For her sins are heaped high as heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities. The end of the world is always death. To follow the course of this world, to follow the prince of the power of the air, brings nothing but death, destruction, and damnation. And for however fair it looks, for however well it seems to do, however successful and prosperous and comfortable, go back to Psalm 37, go back to Psalm 73, however it appears, the end is death, the end is destruction, and God's people are called to come out from it, which is what Asaph learned in Psalm 73. He set them in slippery places. It's but a moment. All their praise and all their hoopla is but a moment. Because when the Lord announces, their end will come, and it will come, and it will be terrible in that evil day. And so all the allurements of the world, they're baits. They're lies, baits, which bury the hook, the snare, right, the trap and ensnare God's people and lead us into destruction. The world may be beautiful, its pleasures may appear to be satisfactory and pleasing, but it's a Sodom of sin that God will one day destroy. Again, turn to 1 John 5. Once again, John puts it so clearly. 5:19, the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. Now turn back to chapter 2. 1 John 2, verse 15. Do not love the world, says John, or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, and then he sums it up, the desires of the flesh, and the desires of the eyes, and the pride of life, all that is in the world is not from the Father, but is from the world, which is in the power of the evil one. And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. And then he goes on talking about the Antichrist, alluring people away by false teaching, that they might turn away from the gospel of salvation. So the world is a dangerous place because it flatters, because it offers many pleasures, it offers comfort, it offers ease, it offers a truce, peace. If we will turn away from the Lord, not be so precise or strict, turn out of the Lord's ways, we will stop seeking Christ and instead embrace the world. So how do we arm ourselves against the world? A few things tonight. We arm ourselves against the flattery of the world. First of all, we flee out of it. We flee out of it like Lot did. There is no way to love both the world and God. We just read it in 1 John 2. There is no way to love both the world and God. Turn to James 4. Again, James makes it very clear as well. James 4, verse 4, look at the language he uses, so strong. Speaking to believers, writing to the church, and he says, you adulterous people, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. It's as clear as day, isn't it? You make yourself a friend with the world, you make yourself at enmity with God. There's no way to have both, right? Go over to to Matthew chapter 6, 24. And remember what our Lord says here. No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. You can't serve God and the world. It's one or the other. Right? This is why the very beginning of the gospel is deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. And Jesus' description of saving someone which we've looked at, right? How he comes on and he attacks the palace of Satan in the heart of a sinner and he rescues someone. His very description of that rescue in John 15 is, I called you out. I took you out of the world, right? And not of the world anymore. He says the very same thing in John 17. I don't pray for the world. I pray for those whom you've given me. Because as I am not of the world, so they are not of the world. A vast, clear distinction. There's no way to have both. There's no way to keep both the world and your own soul. Turn to Mark chapter 8. Again, verse 34. If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. But then verse 35. Whoever would save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake in the Gospels will save it. What is it to save one's life? It's to save one's standing and place in the world. Right? To save your life is to not give up the world. That's the implication here. No, I don't want to lose my life and surrender my life and give Christ my life. I want my life to myself. I want to save my life. I want my place in this world, my standing in this world, the comforts and the enjoyments and the pleasures of this world. I want these things. I'm not willing to trade them. Not willing to give them up for a cross. But whoever would seek to save his life will in fact lose it. Because you can't. There's no salvation there. There's no hope there. Without God and without hope in the world, said Paul. But whoever would lose his life for my sake in the Gospels will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? What can a man give in return for his soul? The soul is of more value than the world. You could have the whole world and it would not be a price great enough to ransom your soul. The only ransom for a soul of a sinner is the very blood of Christ. Whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. And that man will be ashamed. What shame will come to anyone and everyone who chose the world over Christ? Because when Christ comes, it will be clear what a loser they are. Christ said to seek to save your life is to lose it. It's hard to see that from the perspective of the world. It's hard to see that from the perspective of abundance and prosperity and comfort. How am I losing my life? I'm actually keeping my life and enjoying my life. I'm living my life to the full. The testimony of what a great loss you've incurred will be on that day when Jesus comes and you're cast out. You're seen to be not in union and communion with him. And so there's no way to keep both the world and our own soul. Again, the call that we saw even this morning in 1 Peter chapter 2. Remember what Peter says. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession. You may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you, there it is, called you, out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, that's what it means to belong to the world, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, that's Ephesians 2:12, but now you have received mercy. Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak evil of you or speak of you against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. How do we counter this world? How do we arm ourselves against the flattery of the world? We learn to live by faith in the world to come. The best way to wean ourselves from this world is to get our affections set on the world to come. Right? The world that is eternal. The world that is unseen but eternal, because what is seen is transient, says Paul. It passes away with the using, says John. There's no substance to it. There's no endurance to it. It's fading and fleeting and vanity. But the inheritance in store for the people of God is eternal and unfading and incorruptible, because it's an inheritance that comes through and in and by the Lord Jesus Christ. And at the right hand of God is pleasures forevermore, says the psalmist in Psalm 16. At your right hand is pleasures forevermore. And again, Psalm 73, we need to set our affections on things above. Right? There's nothing on earth I desire besides you. You alone are my hope. You alone are my treasure. You alone are my heart's desire. Colossians 3, set your affections, your heart, your mind, all of that on things above. Why? Because that's where Christ is seated. And you're seated with him. And he is your life, it says in verse 4. And when he appears, you will appear with him. And when he appears and you see him, says John, you will be like him. Turn to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews 11, verses 25 and 26. To remember the choice that Moses made. Jeremiah Burroughs wrote an entire treatise, quite large, on Moses' self-denial. Moses' choice, right out of this text. Verse 24, by faith Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God, because that's how the people of God are treated in this world when they choose to follow God, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. Yes, they're pleasures, but they're sinful pleasures, fleeting pleasures, damning pleasures, which means there's no real pleasure at all. Remember the pleasantness of the path of righteousness, the pleasantness of true religion from Matthew Henry. He considered, it says in verse 26, he considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, where he was looking to the reward. That's how to be weaned from this world. Look to the reward, right? So we'll talk about this morning, the preaching of God's word. Look to the recompense that Christ will bring. And once our eyes are set upon the world to come, once our eyes are set upon Christ who comes with his recompense in his hand, then the reproach of Christ is greater wealth than all the treasures of Egypt. Better to be mocked and ridiculed and crucified with Christ than to enjoy the fleeting treasures of Egypt and Babylon. Because to participate with Babylon in her sins is to find participation with Babylon in her plagues, in her judgments. That's Revelation 18. So we need to flee out of the world. Run from the world, take our hearts out of the world. We're not supposed to run from the world in a monastic sense. Paul makes that very, very clear. We need to be in the world. John makes that clear. Christ makes that clear. I saved you as lights, to be upon a hill, to be a witness, to be a testimony. Right? We live in the world, but we don't engage of the world. We're not belonging to the world. We're taken out of it and we flee from it. We don't allow our hearts to get entangled, our passions to get entangled in the world. We live contrary and opposite to it, as those who would seek to please God in the world and to be as holy as a sinner can be in this fallen world. Secondly, then, let us remember that the world's shallow pleasures will plunge us into a bottomless hell, and that the world's songs are but sirens' songs, alluring us to shipwreck our souls on the rocks of sin. All the world's beckoning is a beckoning to destruction. Again, it seems to be a beckoning to pleasure, a beckoning to profit, a beckoning to honor, how John describes the world, and yet we cannot have those things or engage in those things without turning our back upon the Lord Jesus Christ, without turning our back upon true riches, true honor, true pleasure, which is only found in the Lord Jesus Christ. So remember how shallow the world's pleasures are, and remember that it is a call not to life, but to death. Thirdly, remember that to lay in the world's lap is to wake up like Samson, with all our strength gone and ourselves in bondage. Remember Paul's boast? Look at Galatians 6:14. Paul refrained from boasting. No good can come by boasting. But yet Paul boasted in two things. He boasted in the Lord. In Ephesians and Corinthians and Galatians, he boasted in the cross. Look at Galatians 6:14. But far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Why? By which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. It's union and communion with Christ. It's finding life and pleasure and joy in the Lord Jesus Christ that weans us from this world and that makes the world no longer such an attraction to our hearts, because our hearts are already satisfied, right? We're already full. We're not thirsting and hungering after this world and its pleasures and its profits and its honors, because we have found all those things and more to our heart's content, even inexhaustibly so, to our heart's content in the Lord Jesus Christ. Why would we turn to the world when we have found everything we need in the Lord Jesus Christ, an inexhaustible fountain of life and joy and peace? Fourthly, then, we need to remember that for the short, momentary, and empty pleasures of this world, we must forego an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison and plunge ourselves into grievous and endless misery. That's the trade-off. And that's the warning Christ gives in his gospel call, in his evangelistic message. What does a man profit if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? Because to make that choice is to forfeit the soul entirely, because there's nothing that you can give to ransom. It's a terrible trade. It's a foolish trade. It's an eternally miserable trade. If we run after this world, we're choosing short, empty, momentary pleasures. In exchange, we're giving up an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, 2 Corinthians 4:17. That's what Christ has in store for the church. That's what he has in store. This is, as we heard this morning in 1 Corinthians 15:58. Right? Press on, because your labor is not in vain. Look to the recompense. Look to the reward. Right? Is it right for a Christian to look to the reward and recompense? That's one of our questions in the Sunday school class that we'll get to. Is it right to look to the reward? Well, Scripture says in many places that we ought to keep our eyes upon the recompense, because good things are in store, even an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. So beware of a flattering world. Beware of a world that entices and allures and baits, because it always hides a deadly hook. That's on the right hand. But on the left hand, if the world can't succeed in that way, if Satan can't succeed in that way, then Satan uses the world in another fashion. And that is, the world turns her smiles into frowns, her allurements become threats, her pleasures become afflictions, her honors become shames, that she might terrify us and persuade us to make shipwreck of our faith and a good conscience, or if possible, cause us to turn back to Egypt, right? With the lies that Egypt was better. Remember, isn't that what Israel said? It was so much better in Egypt, right? Forgetting the slavery that they were under, forgetting how miserable it was to be forced to make all those bricks and yet without straw being given to them, having to gather their own straw. But all of a sudden, in that perspective, we look back and say, wow, the world is so easy. It was so easy then. No troubles, no persecutions, no sorrows, no hardships. So much ease and so much pleasure. How foolish to believe that. So the world will turn its smiles into frowns. And it becomes terrifying because it threatens. It threatens affliction. It threatens persecution. Right? All the things that we've been learning in Peter. It's wonderful how this overlaps with that. But that's what it threatens. It threatens a mockery and ridicule. And this was Peter's fear. Seeing how his Savior was being treated, seeing how Christ was being treated, Peter was afraid. And what did he do? He sinned in the face of it because of fear. Because he was in danger and he was threatened and he was terrified by the world's frowns. But however, as we've seen from Peter and as we've learned, as we've talked so much about suffering in that context in 1 Peter 4, even though the world looks more terrifying in this situation, yet it's far less dangerous. It's far less dangerous than its flattery. Why? Because believers manage adversity better than prosperity. And the reason is because we're driven more clearly and quickly outside of ourselves. We're driven to the end, where we have nothing but to lean on God, and we find ourselves going to the Lord more fully and frequently, more soon, more early in the game, if you will. We find ourselves learning more quickly that God gives strength sufficient for all of our sufferings, which is all we've been studying. So oftentimes the sufferings and afflictions found in the world are tempered by God with the means to strengthen our faith, to strengthen our hope, our patience, our humility, so that instead of our afflictions destroying us, in God's powerful hands, they work to purge us of our dross, which is exactly what we've been learning. So remember what James says. This is why James says we can rejoice, why we ought to rejoice in our sufferings, in our trials. Why? Because it works this growth in us and maturity in us, this endurance that we read about. He says, count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith in God's hands, and as we submit to our trials, and don't kick against them, but let them do their work, that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. This is how the Lord provides for us, and we so quickly and easily depend upon the Lord, because we realize that God is disciplining us, and that the Lord is doing us good, that he is loving us and ministering to us in a way that we can grow. And so where the world would seek to harm and hurt and destroy us, think of how the world treated Joseph. As you're talking about Joseph this morning, even Joseph, right? Beat down. Daniel thrown in the lion's den. What were these occasions? But occasions of greater communion, greater fellowship. Remember Thomas Case from his time in the Tower of London. Once he was released, he wrote The Treatise of Afflictions, which is so wonderful. If you've never read it, you really need to. We did do a study through it years ago. But remember Thomas Boston said of Thomas Case, he went out of prison when he went into prison. Right? The world was the prison because it's full of distractions, full of difficulties, so hard to find time with God and be alone with God. But in prison, in the Tower of London, Thomas Case had such a wonderful season of communion with God. The Boston says, I wish I could have written the Treatise of Afflictions. But you have to go into prison to be able to write that. You have to go out of the world to be able to write that. And that's what God does. And this is why adversity is so much, comparatively, so much easier for God's people than prosperity. Because the Lord meets us here so tenderly and graciously, and it throws us completely outside of ourselves. Right? What does prosperity do but just puff us up with pride? Puff us up with self-sufficiency. And so we stop praying. We stop leaning on God. We stop looking to the means of grace because we have no needs. We have everything provided by ourselves. But in adversity, we're empty. We're stripped. Right? We are thrown down. And all we can do is look up and cry out. And the Lord provides and meets us. And so we do much better in those situations. And so though the world beats us, yet God uses the world's afflictions to correct us and make us better. The world might throw us into the fires of affliction. God uses it to refine us. The world shakes us with its storms. God uses it to blow our chaff away and to cause us to take deeper root in the face of the storm winds. And so the Lord uses the world in these situations as a schoolmaster to teach us more about Him, His great power, His all-sufficiency, His nearness, His readiness to support and uphold His people in the face of trial. And it teaches us more about ourselves, how weak and frail we are, and how dependent we are, and needy we are. And so we learn to cry out to God, right? We learn to look to the Lord. I think it was John Trapp that says, if a man doesn't know how to pray, let him go out to sea. He'll learn to pray. Faced by such trials and adversities, all he can do is pray. And that's what we learn in trials and afflictions, so that we'll learn to labor for a more permanent happiness in God. When we're in afflictions, what do we see? We see the world's vanities. We see that nothing matters, right? What is it, you know, what are the world's gifts to a man who is suffering? What is gold to a man who is dying under suffering, affliction, and trial? It's of no use at all. We begin to see through the world's vanities and the world's emptiness in the face of trial and affliction. This is exactly what happened to Israel. Turn to Hosea chapter 2. It's a very familiar passage. Hosea chapter 2. The Lord rebukes His people. He speaks here of Israel's unfaithfulness to Him. Remember what James said, you adulterous people, that's the language here. He says of His own people in verse 5, for their mother has played the whore, she who conceived them has acted shamefully. For she said, I will go after my lovers who give me my bread and my water, my wool and my flax, my oil and my drink. Notice that. What is that? That's the flattery of the world. That's the first thing, right? Notice how is Israel handling prosperity? Which the Lord says later, all of that, your flax, your oil, your grain, that came from me. I gave that to you. In that prosperity, right, a land flowing with milk and honey, what did Israel do? Israel did not do well in a land flowing with milk and honey. They did a lot better in Babylon, right? And so she says, I will go after my lovers because they give me my bread, my water, my wool, my flax, my oil, and my drink. Therefore, says the Lord, because of His love for His people, I will hedge up her way with thorns. Prosperity wasn't helpful in that sense, but what will thorns do? I will hedge up her way with thorns. I will build a wall against her so that she cannot find her paths to her lovers. She shall pursue her lovers, but not overtake them. She shall seek them, but she shall not find them. And then, in the furnace, in affliction, in prosperity, guess what? She comes to her senses. It's the parable of the prodigal son, right? He came to himself. When he was in the pigsty, right? Then she shall say, I will go and return to my first husband, to the Lord. For it was better for me then than now. And she did not know, because of her willful ignorance, she did not know that it was I who gave her the grain, the wine, and the oil, and who lavished on her silver and gold, which they used for Baal. Therefore I will take back my grain in its time, and my wine in its season, and I will take away my wool and my flax, which were to cover her nakedness. And on he goes. And I'll put an end to all her mirth, and I will lay waste her vines and her fig trees. I will punish her, because she went after her lovers and forgot me, declares the Lord. Now notice verse 14. Therefore, behold, I will allure her. The world allures. God says, I will allure her and bring her where? Into the wilderness. And what will God do in the wilderness? Speak tenderly to her. See the Lord? See how well, how wisely, how lovingly and graciously God uses the wilderness? Trials and afflictions. The Lord meets his people. We do better in those situations, which is why, as we've seen in Peter, and as Jesus says in John 15 and 16, it's why the church is called to a suffering condition, right? The church is like the church. The church is always pictured so well in the book of Numbers. We're going through a wilderness. We're traveling to the promised land, the celestial city. But we are traversing a wilderness world. And so though the world afflicts us, God in his grace uses all of these things as a schoolmaster so that we will labor for a more permanent happiness in God. But we will never labor for a more permanent happiness in God until we're convinced that there's no happiness in the world for us. Thirdly, though adversity often has these good effects on us, in itself, adversity, the furnace, in itself, it's a strong temptation to draw us from God by causing us to murmur and complain, and if possible, to curse him to his face, which is exactly how Satan, is what Satan said affliction would do in the course of Job, which it did not. Affliction in itself can cause us to envy those who seem happier than we are. Asaph in Psalm 73. Affliction by itself can cause us to despair of God's mercy. Psalm 10, how long, O Lord? Where are you? Right? Psalm 10, verse 1. And by itself, the furnace can cause us to use unlawful means to better our condition. Peter in the courtyard of the high priest. Sin, right, to better his condition, which looked very terrible as his Savior, the one with whom he was associated, was being persecuted. Therefore, we come to several applications again. Therefore, it behooves us to arm ourselves against the violence of the world, no less than against the flattery of the world. Just as the flattery of the world is enticing, right, and challenging for God's people to handle, right, so the afflictions and the suffering and the violence of the world is also a challenge. When we forget to look at God and see it in the hand of God, all the stuff we've been learning. So this is a wonderful review. So here's four things tonight, and then we'll close. How do we arm ourselves against the violence of the world? First of all, we need to remember that our fatherly corrections are testimonies to assure us. Number one, that we are not illegitimate. Remember Hebrews 12. Our fatherly afflictions assure us that we're not illegitimate children, but rather we are God's dear children whom he gently chastens in order that we might not be judged with the world. 1 Peter 4:17. Now is the time for judgment to begin at the house of God. Hebrews 12:6-8. Don't forget that the Lord disciplines every son he receives. It's for discipline that you have to endure your sufferings. God is disciplining you. And then that great passage in 1 Corinthians 11:32, right? If we're disciplined by the Lord, it's so that we won't be condemned with the world. What a wonderful, wonderful text that we looked at when we were going through Peter. Secondly, it's a testimony to assure us. Our fatherly corrections are testimonies to assure us, secondly, that Christ has chosen us out of the world. Right? If we are at odds with the world and the world hates us, and if it's for our love for Jesus, then it shows that we really are Christ's disciples. Right? This is why, remember what Peter says, let no one suffer as a meddler, as an evildoer. But if we suffer because of our love for Jesus, that's a testimony of God's love for you. If the world is at enmity with you, if the world is your enemy, then Christ is your friend, right? That's what we learned in Peter. And what a great encouragement. Don't lose the encouragement that comes through suffering. And thirdly, our fatherly corrections are testimony to assure us that we are God's friends because the world is our enemy. not only God's friends, we're chosen by Christ out of the world, and we are the temples of the Holy Spirit. The triune God has taken us into fellowship with himself, and it's as clear as day, because the world hates us for our holiness. The world despises and mocks us for our love for Jesus. Truly, we belong to the Lord if the world hates us on those grounds. Secondly, we need to remember the recompense and reward that await all of those who love Jesus. Again, back to Moses, right? The reproach of Christ is greater treasure than all the treasures of Egypt. Right? Remember the recompense and the reward that await all those who love Jesus. Because if we keep that perspective, then again, we'll gladly endure with Moses. We'll gladly endure to be tried and purified in the furnace of afflictions. Because we know that after we have been proven to be true gold, the Lord will take us into his treasure of everlasting happiness. Which takes us back to 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 6 and 7. Right? Rejoice in the trying of your faith to test its genuineness. If necessary, says Peter, and it is necessary, if necessary, you be tried to test the genuineness of your faith. But it will give way, what? To praise and glory at the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't forget that, right? Again, Paul, 2 Corinthians 4, 17 and 18, right? These light, momentary afflictions are preparing for us an eternal weight of glory. I've gotten ahead of myself. That's number four. All right, letter C, remember. Remember, thirdly, then, that eternal blessedness is promised to those who mourn with a godly sorrow. And eternal woe is promised against those who live for the world. Let's look at these verses. Look at Matthew 5 and then Luke 6. Matthew 5, we find ourselves in the Sermon on the Mount, verse 4. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. That's a promise. And again, verse 10, another promise. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We can keep reading. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. You are in good company. If you find yourself in Hebrews 11, you're in good company. That's exactly what Jesus says there. Now turn to Luke chapter 6. Luke 6. Also the Beatitudes. Luke 6, he says in verse 21, blessed are you who are hungry now, for you shall be satisfied. Look at verse 25. Woe to you who are full now, for you shall be hungry. Notice that. Nothing comes from following this world but emptiness and loss. As I said earlier, if we're filled with the world, right? If we're full of the world, we are no longer for heaven. But the best way to be weaned from this world is to be full of Christ and full of heaven, full of glory, full of the longing for what is to come. So remember what God has promised to those who go through life with a godly sorrow, mourning over our own sins, mourning over a fallen world that is going contrary to God, mourning over a troubled and polluted church and all the things that we should mourn over. There is blessings in store for God's people. And then finally, remember that however great your troubles are, they are but light, momentary afflictions that in God's hands, for all of his people, are working an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. Again, don't lose sight of what God is doing through all of our troubles and our trials. And John Downham ends this way, why then should this little spot of foul weather cause us to stand still or go out of the course which leads to everlasting happiness? That's all the world is, especially in its afflictions and in all of its violence to the church. It's but a spot of foul weather. Why would we step out, right? Why would we leave the course that we're on when the course leads to everlasting happiness? Whoever on a journey to a wonderful place of vacation, a wonderful destination, whoever turned around because it rained, the weather will pass, right? A storm, but it will pass. And we carry on to our destination. How much more to the glory that awaits us as God's people? Keep your eyes on things above. Again, we come back to Colossians 3. Set your affections, your where your heaven is. That's where the joy is that awaits you. And that's where all the peace is that the Lord is building for us. And we begin to taste that even now through life as we walk in the ways of the Lord and not in the ways of the world. So the world is a terrible enemy, and we need to be aware of it. And don't be deceived by it. And remember, Satan uses it. It is a tool in his hand. And either by flattery or by violence, seeking to hinder God's people and turn us out of the way of life and life and truth. But stay in the narrow way and follow the Lord Jesus.